Good morning, BBC Church. Welcome to our Connect online service for the 13th of September. Thank you for joining us in your homes, with your families, and we pray that this service would be one that encourages you and still feeds you and keeps you spiritually nourished, even though we can't meet together in person. I want to just encourage you to keep making use of these. I know it's been going on for a long time, this inability to meet as a church, but as we look forward to an easing off of the regulations and things to start opening up, I just encourage you to keep going and to keep making sure that you're spiritually fed and growing, even though we cannot be a community together in person. I want to start the service by reading our call to worship, which is taken from Psalm chapter 31, and I'm going to read from verse 19 through to verse 24. And it reads, "How great is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you, which you bestow in the sight of men on those who take refuge in you. In the shelter of your presence you hide them from the intrigues of men. In your dwelling you keep them safe from accusing tongues. Praise be to the Lord, for he has showed his wonderful love to me when I was in a besieged city. In my alarm I said, 'I am cut off from your sight.' Yet you heard my cry for mercy when I called to you for help. Love the Lord, all his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord." Let's open the service in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can gather today, even though it is online and the service comes through to us over the internet. We know that you are with us. We know that you are present in our lounges, in our rooms, where we are watching now. And we ask, Lord, that you would continue to work in us. We ask that you would continue to teach us and grow us every day and through this service. Lord, may our time of worship be one where we feel your presence, where we know that you are there, and where we can bring praise and glory to a Lord who has heard our cries. We pray for Darren as he brings your word. We pray that the words of scripture spoken through him would be teaching us as well. We pray that they would be sharpening us, that they would be growing us, that they would be giving us lessons to know you more and to understand you deeper. Lord, teach us, give us strength for the days, the long days of isolation, the long days when we cannot meet together. But Lord, we know that you are there. We know that your hand is over us, and we ask that you would sustain us until we can meet again in person. Thank you that we can still be a part of a church. Thank you that you love us and that you do care for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Stare in me a passion that my heart cannot contain. I've come to worship you. Stare in me the fire that the world cannot explain. I've come to worship. stir in me the passion that my heart cannot contain. I've come to worship you. Stir in me, Lord, the fire that the world cannot display. I've come to worship you. So hold me,
break me,
bring me, hold me and make me more and more like you.
I've come, Lord,
I've come to worship you,
to love you, from me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hand. Majesty, majesty,
majesty,
forever. We're singing majesty, majesty. Yes, we're singing Majesty, 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 forever. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. Clothed in rainbow, a living color, flashes of lightning, rose of thunder. Let's sing in honor, strength, and glory and power be to You, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, of Your name. Jesus, Your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And is to come. All creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You.
Church family, good morning and welcome. As you join us on our BBC Connect platform this morning, wherever you may be, so excited that you've been able to join us. You've just seen a short clip of some of the exciting stuff that's taking place amongst the Tawala family, our missionary family in Chimoyo, Mozambique. So exciting to see their church building coming up. They're going to be calling it the House of Prayer. So exciting to see the community coming together and all getting stuck into the this building project. May you continue to pray for them as God continues to show them His great provision in the building of the House of Prayer. And so with that being said, I want to say a huge thank you to our missionaries. And I want to ask you, church, to continue to remember them and to lift them up in prayer as they continue to labor faithfully in the fields that are white unto harvest. So thank you. We thank the Lord for Thomas and Edith and their girls, Tiffany and Jeddah, serving the Lord in Chimoyo, Mozambique. We thank the Lord for our missionaries in the UK, for Mike and Linda Van Furen. We thank the Lord for Steve and Anthea Love and their children, Ian, Fiona, and Kayla, and their work here in Zimbabwe. So thank you to our missionaries for your faithful service. We, as your church family, love you, and we remember you in our prayers, and we thank God for your faithful work. I also want to say thank you to Sheila for these beautiful beautiful flowers, this beautiful arrangement this morning. Remember to pray for Sheila. She will, Lord willing, be flying out this coming Thursday to the UK for a few months. Sheila, may the Lord bless you as He takes you into this next season and chapter of your life. But brothers and sisters, so exciting that we can gather together this morning. We're going to start a new series, entitled The Armour of God. And so the first part of our series this morning is going to be titled The Battle. So as we look at the armor of God, we're going to be looking at the battle. And I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles to the sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians. And we're going to be looking at verses 10 through to 13 this morning. But before we come to God's word, I'm going to ask if you would bow your heads with me as we pray together. Our Father, we thank you for our BBC Connect platform. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to still be able to do church together. And Father, as we gather in our homes in various places this morning, I pray, Holy Spirit, that we would meet with you and Jesus, you would meet with us. And Father, I pray that as we interact with your word, that we would be transformed more and more into the likeness of yourself. And Lord, I pray that you would bring understanding to us as we look at the armor of God this morning. And so, Father, I ask that you would make our eyes to see and our ears to hear. That, Lord, you would cause our minds to understand and, Jesus, our hearts to receive your word this morning. That we might prove by experience that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And, Lord, I pray that I would be nothing. For, Jesus, I am nothing. And, my Lord, that you would be everything, for you truly are everything. To the praise of your glorious and wonderful and beautiful and amazing grace, Lord Jesus. Amen. And so we're looking at Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through to 13. We're talking about the armor of God, and this morning we're going to be looking, before we even talk about the various pieces that we are to wear, we're going to be looking at the battle that we're up against. And so the word of God reads as follows in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10. The apostle Paul writes and he says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." And verse 12, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." Therefore, Paul says, "Take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." Friends, I want to start out by saying this. We are living in an age and we are living in a time where Satan is increasing his efforts, where Satan is increasing his attack, and where Satan is increasing his assault on God's people and on God's church. And it is important for us to recognize that we are in a battle. Know your opponent and trust your commander in chief. And so that's the heart of the message this morning, church, is that we are in a battle. Know your opponent and know your commander in chief. I'm sure you'll agree with me that we are living in trying times. We are living in times of chaos. We are living in times of increasing wickedness in the world today, and Satan would desire to distract us from the things which really matter, because if he can do that, then he can launch a surprise attack upon God's people. And so it is so important for us, church, to understand in these days that we need to be alert, we need to be awake, we need to be aware, and we need to be vigilant in these days if we are to endure to the end. Church, we are engaged in a spiritual warfare. Satan and his demons are doing all that they can to undermine the work of God in the world. Satan and his demons are doing all they can to undermine the word of God in the world. They are doing all they can to distract, to discourage, to defeat, and to destroy God's people. And it is important for us to understand that there is a battle that is going on for the souls of men and for the souls of women. And we are fighting for our lives. Brothers and sisters, we are in a battle. And it is important that we know our opponent, it is important that we know our enemy, and it is important that we trust our commander-in-chief, Jesus Christ. And so as we come to the book of Ephesians, and as we look at the contextual background to what's going on here, in the first three verses, what the Apostle Paul has been doing is he has been talking about our position in Jesus Christ. And then as he gets to chapter 4, we're moving from the doctrinal matters to the practical implications. And so for the next 2.5 chapters, from Ephesians chapter 4 to half of chapter 6, Paul is talking about the practical implications of who we are in Jesus Christ. As he gets to chapter 6 and verse 10, he then addresses the reality that we are in a spiritual warfare here. And we need to understand, brothers and sisters, that we are not in a playground, but rather we are on a battleground, and we are fighting for our lives, and we are fighting for our faith, and we are fighting for the survival of the Church of Jesus Christ in these last days. And so the Word of God says, finally, my brethren, in verse 10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Friends, we are reminded that this is no easy battle. We are reminded that this is not a walk through the park. We are reminded that we need the strength to confront the enemy. And so when the Apostle Paul says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord in the power of His might, what he's actually saying is be strengthened. And the only way that we can be strengthened is by the Spirit of God, who enables and empowers and equips us for this battle that we are up against. As we face the spiritual warfare, we need to be reminded that we do not empower ourselves. We need to be reminded that we do not fight in our own strength. We need to be reminded that we do not engage in battle by our own skills, but rather we come into this battle by the power of the Lord and by the power of His might. And it is a spiritual battle, church. And so we cannot fight it with physical means. With physical warfare, but we fight it with spiritual weapons. You see, we cannot engage in this battle because we think that we're smart, or because we think that we're clever, or because we think that we're intelligent. We're not capable to come into this battle because we think that we're strong, or because we think that we're fit, or we're healthy, or we're fast, or we're quick. Because if we do, we will soon come short. And so what the Word of God wants us to understand is this: our strength is inadequate to wage this kind of war. We don't have what it takes within ourselves to come against the schemes and the systems of the devil. The only way that we can engage in battle, And the only way that we can be victorious is in the power of the might of Jesus Christ. And we need to draw upon His power, and we need to yield to Him, and we need to surrender to Him. The Word of God says, when the Apostle Paul is writing to the church in Rome, in Romans chapter 8 and verse 11, he says, if the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwells within us, He too will quicken our mortal bodies. Friends, we are up against spiritual warfare here, and we need the Spirit of God to empower us to stand, because if we don't, we will quickly fall. And yes, Satan possesses power, but what I want us to understand is God possesses all power. God stood before creation. He created everything out of nothing. He has power over all things. Jesus Christ has power over kingdoms, and He has power over nations. He has power over Satan, and He has power over his demons. And we need to understand that He has power over sin, and He has power over death. You see, church, sometimes we may feel discouraged, and sometimes we may feel defeated. Because at times we may go into this battle and we may confront Satan and his dominion of darkness and his demons by our own strength rather than by the strength of the Lord. And church, in these last days, we need to depend upon the power of His might. We need to yield to the Holy Spirit, and we need to trust our Commander in Chief. In verse 11, the Apostle Paul says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We need to be spiritually equipped, and we need to be spiritually prepared for this battle. Ill-preparedness will result in our defeat and will result in our destruction. We need to put on the whole armor of God, and the Lord willing, in the coming weeks, we're going to break it down and look at the various pieces of that armor. But as we start out this morning, we're reminded we need to put on the whole armor of God. It's not just part of the armor, it's the whole armor of God if we're to stand against the attacks of the enemy. The same way that a soldier cannot go into battle with his rifle whilst forgetting his ammunition clip or his ammunition cartridge, so we too cannot go into battle missing some of the armor of God if we're to be victorious in the battle. The same way that a soldier cannot go into battle with his uniform whilst forgetting his helmet is the same way the Word of God is reminding us that we are in a spiritual warfare here, and we need to be well prepared and we need to be well equipped. In order that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil is what the Word of God says. And that word stand means to hold a critical position during an enemy attack. It means to not even back up one inch from the enemy, to not allow him to gain any ground on us. And believers in these days, as the enemy would seek to launch an attack on the church of Jesus Christ, believers, we must stand firm in the power of the might of Jesus Christ. We must not back out. We must not back down. But we must keep pressing on as we stand against the wiles of the enemy. When we talk about the wiles of the enemy, we're talking about the methods that Satan uses. You see, church, he is cunning, he is crafty, he is clever, and he is conniving. And he is battling for the souls of men and women. The Bible says that in the last days there will be a great falling away. And church, if we are not prepared for this battle, then we will fall away from the faith. And so we need to cling to Jesus Christ, and we need to trust our Commander-in-Chief, and we need to know the seriousness of this battle that we are up against. You see, Satan will stop at nothing to destroy us. He will use every trick, he will use every tactic, he will use every deception to deceive us, to defeat us, and to destroy us. And so we must know our enemy and we must know our opponent, because the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." We must know our enemy. We must understand the battle that we're in. We must understand, church, listen, our struggle, the Bible says, is not against flesh and blood. We must understand that the struggles that we face are not with each other. You see, because that's what Satan wants to do. He wants us to believe that our struggle is with flesh and blood. He wants us to believe that our struggle is with each other. Yes, people may hurt us. Yes, people may lie about us, or they may lie to us. Yes, people may gossip about us. Yes, people may scandal or be malicious. But we need to understand that our struggle is not with people. Because Satan knows that if he can have us squabbling amongst ourselves and fighting amongst ourselves, he knows that he can distract us from that which really matters, which is the work of ministry and the kingdom of God. And he knows then that he can divide God's church and he can hurt God's church. And so the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities and powers. We wrestle against the rulers of the darkness of this age. We wrestle against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And so we need to know who the true enemy is. And we wrestle, church. We wrestle. This is not a walk through the park. This is a picture of two opponents, of two men coming against each other in combat and throwing one another around until finally one is able to overpower the other and to get them to submit. And that's what Satan is trying to do. He is making one last desperate attempt to draw to himself as many people as he can, so that we might fall by the wayside, so that he might take us into eternal hell. In verse 3 of the book of Jude, as Jude writes, he tells us, believers, contend for the faith. We need to contend for the faith. We need to fight for the faith. Because we're in a battle. Satan and his demons are out to defeat, to demolish, to dismantle, and to destroy the kingdom of God. But we know that he cannot. But he will try to take down some of God's people. And that's why we must know the enemy. A commander-in-chief will never send his army and his soldiers into battle without them first knowing and studying their opponent. An individual athlete or a whole sports team will not go against another team without first knowing and studying that team for themselves. And so, church, we need to know and we need to understand how cunning and how conniving and how deceitful our enemy is. Because if we don't, he will trip us up. And sadly, there are many who have already succumbed to that. You see, as we study the enemy, church, we need to understand that he is the one who once was Lucifer, the son of the morning, the anointed cherub fallen from heaven, who is now the ruler of the demon world. He is an old, old enemy who has been around from the beginning of creation. He opposes God's work. He perverts God's work. He deceives the nations, is what the word of God tells us. He is called the prince of this world. He is called the prince of the power of this age. He is called the prince of demons. He is called the god of this age. He has personal names 52 times. He is called Satan, the adversary. 35 times he is called Diabolos, the devil, the slanderer. He is the old serpent and he is the great dragon. He is the destroyer, the accuser, the tempter, the murderer, and the liar. He masquerades as an angel of light. He is the great great imitator. He wants to be God. He is an ancient foe. He has been attacking God's people through the generations from the beginning of time, starting with Adam and Eve. And church, we need to understand this. Our enemy has over 6,000 years of experience in battle. So we must not take him lightly. We must not underestimate him. And I want us to understand something here, church. I am not giving him any glory. And I am not trying to elevate Satan and his demons in any way. But what I want us to understand is I want us to understand that he is the ultimate enemy. He is out for God's people and he is attacking God's kingdom. And it's so important for us to understand, church, because I think too often we underestimate the tact of the devil, and that's when we fall. So unless we know who the enemy is, unless we know how he works, and unless we know what he is capable of, we will have a hard time defeating him. This is the battle, and we need the armor of God. But we know our commander-in-chief. Though Satan has power, only God is all-powerful. There is none who can contend with our God. From nothing he spoke creation into being. He is the Alpha and he is the Omega. He is the advocate and he is the deliverer. He is faithful and true. He is the King of kings. He is the judge. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is the Lord of all. He is the mediator. He is the mighty one. He is the resurrection and the life. He is Yahweh. He is the Messiah. He is the self-existent God, the one who has no beginning and the one who has no end. He descends from no one and he needs nothing from anyone. This is the God whom we serve, and it is this great God in whom we stand and by whom we are strengthened to face this battle. This is the God we serve. And so, friends, we are in a battle. We must know our opponent, and we must trust our commander in chief. And then verse 11, the Apostle Paul in many ways repeats what he has said. In verse 13, he repeats what he said in verse 11. Verse 13, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Paul reminds us, church, that we are up against a formidable foe. And if we want to withstand his attacks and his assault, we need to put on the whole armor of God. We need to be prepared and we need to be equipped. We must hold our position. We must refuse to yield even one inch of ground to our enemy. We must not back up. We must not back down. We must not back out. We must not abandon our post. We must not abandon the faith, but we must put on the whole armor of God in order that we might stand firm and in order that we might stand fast in these last days when many will fall by the wayside. We are living in strange times. This pandemic has brought new challenges to us. And in many ways, I fear that the world will never, ever be the same again. And I fear that the Church of Jesus Christ will never be the same again. And Satan is heating things up. And he's expediting his attack and his assault. And we must know our enemy. We must know that we're in a battle. It is a battle for the souls of men and the souls of women. And friends, as we come to a close this morning, and as we gaze into the mirror of God's Word, friend, maybe you've been feeling discouraged. Maybe you've been feeling despairing. Maybe you've been feeling deflated and defeated. Maybe you've been trying to go this battle on your own and you are feeling washed out, worn out, and exhausted. Maybe you've already fallen prey to Satan's schemes, and you feel as though you've already lost the battle. I want to tell you that as we come to Jesus Christ in repentance and confession, so He forgives us and draws us back to Himself. He dusts us off, He picks us up, and He tells us that the battle is not over. You see, friends, this is exactly what Satan seeks to do. He seeks to use various means and various forms of everyday life to discourage us and distract us. And he seeks to chisel away, and he seeks to knock us down and knock us down and knock us down. But we are to put on the whole armor of God in order that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We are called to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. But don't treat this battle as a playground, because it's a battleground. And we must be prepared and we must be equipped. We must get into God's Word and get to know the God of the Bible, get to know our all-powerful, all-sufficient God. We must spend time communicating with Him and connecting in prayer and sensing His heartbeat. We must not forsake the gathering of the saints. We must fellowship with brothers and sisters and people who are like-minded, as iron sharpens iron, is what we're called to do. We must nurture our faith. We must grow our faith in these days, church. We are fighting for our survival. We are in a battle. We must know our opponent, and we must trust our commander in chief. He is the Lord of hosts. Satan is actively fighting against Jesus and His kingdom. All of his efforts are being focused on breaking us down and on shattering the unity of the church of Jesus Christ and leading many astray. But those who will put on the whole armor of God, those who will draw upon the strength of Jesus Christ, the strength of the Spirit within us, will endure to the end. Satan may be described as the god of this age, but Jesus Christ is the God of this universe. And not long from now, Satan will be issued that final blow and be given his final definitive sentence. But victory is sure for those who stand in the power of the Lord and the strength of His might. And so, friends, let us stand in His power. Let us lean on His grace. And let us call on His name. For He fights for His people. And friend, if you're watching or you're listening today and you are not saved, I want to tell you that that's where Satan wants you. Satan wants to deceive you. He wants you to think and believe that you can make it through life on your own. He wants you to think that this is all that there is to life. Or maybe you're staying away because people have hurt you. Christians have disappointed you. The church has hurt you. That is the deceiver. That's what he wants you to think, and that's what he wants you to believe. But Jesus Christ came that you may have life. And today I ask you the question, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, will you quit listening to the lies of the devil and listen to the truth of God, that He loves you with an eternal, everlasting love, that He gave His only Son Jesus to die on the cross, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life? Will you take up this offer of eternal life? And then will you put on the full armor of God? And will you get into the battlefield? And will you fight and contend for the faith? There is a battle that is going on, brothers and sisters. There is an attack and an assault on God's kingdom and God's people. But those who are in Him will still be standing tall and standing strong long after the battle is done. Bow your heads as we pray together. Our God and our Father, Lord of hosts, we worship you today. We recognize that you are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. There is none, Jesus, who can contend with you. You are on your throne. You have always been on your throne. You will always be on your throne. But we do know, Lord, that we are up against principalities and powers, Lord. We recognize that there is a spiritual battle that is taking place, a battle for the souls of men and women. We know that Satan's time is running out and there is this last desperate effort to draw many away, that many would fall by the wayside. And so, Father, I pray that we would understand how important it is that we be strong in you, Lord, and in the power of your might. Father, I pray that you would strengthen your people where your people have grown discouraged and weary, where they have been feeling beaten down, Lord. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would strengthen them, that you would enable and empower and equip us for this battle. Forgive us for where we've tried to do battle in our own strength, Lord, and found that we fail time and time again. Thank you for the power of your Spirit that is available to us. And I pray that you would raise up a mighty, mighty army that will do battle for the kingdom of God. And that we would be faithful in proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ as we battle for the souls of men and women. And for those, Lord, who feel like they've already fallen to Satan's schemes and systems, for those who feel that they've already lost the battle, may you remind them today, the battle's not over. As they repent of that sin, as they confess Jesus, may you forgive us, pick us up, dust us off, place us back in the battlefield. And Father, if there's someone listening or watching today who has never surrendered their life to you, someone watching or listening who has been deceived by the liar, the murderer, and the thief, who has had them believing, Lord, that they don't need salvation, that they don't need saving, may you remove the scales from their eyes so that they may see who we are apart from you. And friend, if that's you today, will you surrender your life to Jesus? If we confess with our mouths the Lord Jesus and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, the Bible says we shall be saved. Would you make that decision today to come into his kingdom because of what he did in his death, burial, and resurrection? And then having done that, would you get into a church, Bible-believing, Christ-teaching church? Would you get reading the Word of God? Would you get praying and spending time with the Lord in prayer? And then would you get with other believers who are like-minded so that you might grow in your faith and then put on the full armor of God and walk the path that Jesus calls you to? Father, thank you that we need not back down, that we need not fear this enemy, because you have already defeated this foe. You are all powerful. And not long from now, Lord, you will give him his final sentence. But in these days, may you enable us to stand firm and to stand fast, to contend for the faith, and to endure to the end as we put on the full armor of God. And thank you, Lord, that victory is ours through the Spirit of Jesus Christ. In your precious and mighty name, amen and amen.
song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My